2 Corinthians 4, 1 through 6. What I want to draw your attention to in these six verses is what we learn from the Apostle Paul here concerning directions for those who preach the gospel. So really, the title of this and what we need to frame all of this as is how you and I must and must not preach the gospel. So Paul has nine things I'm going to point you to, or nine things we can glean from these six verses. And some of them are do not do this, and some of them are do this. And we're learning by his example. He's saying, this is what I and the apostles and the other ministers with me do, and this is what we don't do. So if we're going to take this and understand it and then apply it to ourselves, we need to think, this is what you and I must and must not do as we preach the gospel. So nine directions. And each of these, each one of these can be applied to formal preaching, like I'm doing right now. That's what I mean by formal preaching. There's a set time when people gather together to hear the preaching of the Word of God. It can be applied, each one of these, to family worship. When you men lead your families just in an ordinary, simple Bible study that's not as organized or structured maybe as a formal sermon may be. This can also be applied to small groups where you're studying the Bible just in more of a communal fellowship type setting and there's feedback and back and forth. It can be applied to that. It can be applied to open air preaching. You're preaching at the abortion mill or on the street corner, and maybe it's much less structured than a formal sermon may be, and there may be give and take between other people who are there. It can be applied to that as well. And you can also apply all of these nine directions to your ordinary one-on-one evangelism. So it can be applied to formal preaching, family worship, small groups, open-air preaching, and personal evangelism. Now I'm going to phrase every point that I'm going to draw your attention to and every point I'm going to make as you preach the gospel, and we'll fill in the blank, okay? So as you preach the gospel, and by that I don't just mean formal, I mean all of the things that I've mentioned to you, every way you can think about that you would be speaking the gospel to other people one-on-one or a big group, informal, formal, whatever it may be. The first thing I want you to see, look at chapter 4, verse 1, where he says, therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart. Therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart. This can be one of the problems in having the Bible translated and laid out in the way that we do. If you're not careful, you can miss a point. You can miss the point that Paul's making because probably in your Bible, like it is in mine, it's a new section with a new heading. Is it in yours? My heading says the light of the gospel. It's a whole new section, but the word therefore is the very first word in verse 1 of chapter 4, which means what? We need to look before and see what came before that. We need to see what the therefore is there for. And if you don't grasp that, you're not really going to understand the force of why Paul says, we do not lose heart. I'll draw your attention to that here in just a minute. But the doctrinal point that you need to learn right here in verse 1 of chapter 4 is as you preach the gospel, you will not lose heart if you keep the eyes of your heart firmly fixed on Jesus. You will not lose heart if you keep the eyes of your heart firmly fixed on Jesus. That's what the therefore means. Therefore, what I've just said, having this ministry by the mercy of God, we do not lose heart. You need to understand that in any kind of active ministry, even just seeking to be a shepherd of your home, you will be tempted repeatedly to lose heart. Robert Murray McShane, speaking specifically about pastors, ministers of the gospel in the formal sense, he says, There are many things that are apt to make a minister faint or lose heart. No natural man could bear what faithful ministers do. One thing that is apt to make us faint, or to make us lose heart, is the reproach of the world. You remember what they called our master. They called him a wine-bibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. These words are very bitter. And then again, I do not know anything more difficult to bear than the reproach of rich, worldly men. They look on all of our endeavors to save them as hateful. Another thing is, whether when people leave our ministry, when they go away, and we have the sad thought concerning them that they went back and walked no more with Jesus. Another thing is seeing many of us staying and yet living unconverted. Brethren, if there is anything that is like to make us faint, it is these things. But why would Paul have been tempted to lose heart? Why does Paul make sure that the Corinthians he's writing to knows that he and his companions, he's saying, we do not lose heart? What would he have to lose heart about? Well, the very reason he's writing this letter is because a church that he planted, God caused the growth, but he planted the seeds, God causes the growth. He felt like they were his spiritual children. After he has left for a time, false teachers infiltrate the church and try to assassinate Paul's character and undermine the ministry that he had labored for in their midst. These spiritual children of him have other people coming in and poisoning them against him as the church planter, as the apostle that God had sent there to plant the church. So his spiritual children were starting to look at him as insignificant, and they shouldn't trust him anymore because of these false teachers poisoning them against him. Consider also the constant persecution that Paul underwent as he traveled across the entire known world at that time to preach the gospel and to plant churches. It's estimated that with all of the travels that he did in his missionary journeys, he walked an average of 15 miles a day. That's how much he walked. Calculated it all up, and that's what he was constantly doing. Walking from one place to another, he'd go into a city, a few people may believe, and then the rest of them would try to kill him. He'd go into Philippi, people get converted, and then they throw him in prison and put his legs in the stocks and try to split his legs apart. You can go to the end of 2 Corinthians where he lists all the persecutions that he has undergone. He had many reasons to lose heart. Yet he tells us, first of all, here in verse 1 of chapter 4, me and my companions do not lose heart. And the reason he doesn't lose heart, first of all, is that he knows God has installed him in this ministry. That's why he says, therefore, having this ministry by the mercy of God. He knew he had received this ministry from the Lord Jesus Christ himself. He didn't lose heart, first knowing that he took his orders from heaven. We have this ministry by the mercy of God. By the mercy of God. God selected him to be the apostle to the Gentiles. It was a mercy of God that God selected Paul to suffer in the way that Paul suffered. And so he didn't lose heart, knowing that this is what the Lord has assigned for me. But the second reason he didn't lose heart, and what the first word in verse 1 points us to, is verse 18 in chapter 3. And the reason is, his eyes were fixed on the Lord Jesus, beholding his glory. That's how he did not lose heart. Look at verse 18 in chapter 3. And we all, with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. He had the eyes of his heart firmly fixed on the Lord Jesus. beholding the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Spirit is transforming him from one degree of glory to another. And then he says, therefore, we don't lose heart. That's the only way you're not going to lose heart in family worship. That's the only way you're not going to lose heart in any kind of public ministry, in personal evangelism, in open air type preaching or pleading at the abortion mills. This is the only way you're not going to lose heart teaching and preaching to a small group that you're a part of. You must have your eyes firmly fixed on the Lord Jesus Christ, knowing that wherever you find yourself, whatever duties you've got to do, ultimately that has come from the hand of the Lord, and he has made you responsible for certain people to preach the truth to them. Fix your eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the remedy to losing heart. And that's really got to be the foundation of everything we're saying tonight, because that's Paul's foundation when he gets into how they do and do not preach the gospel. This is what the Church of Jesus Christ desperately needs right now and always. We need men who will shepherd God's flock, even the flock in their households. We need men who will not shrink back, who will not grow weary, who will not flag or faint in the day of adversity. The church today, as always, needs men to courageously preach the word of God in the church, in their homes, with their small groups, in the public square, one-on-one, even with unbelievers. We need men who will stand up and say, throw anything you want at me, but I have received this charge from the Lord Jesus Christ, and my eyes are firmly fixed on him. I will not lose heart. The only way you can say that is if your eyes are fixed on Christ. If your eyes are fixed on your circumstances, you will lose heart. If your eyes are fixed internally on yourself and how you are doing, if that's where your gaze is constantly drawn, if you only ever self-examine yourself and you never are gazing at Jesus, you're going to lose heart. There's no encouragement to be found in navel gazing. You should examine yourselves. You should ask the Lord to examine you and see if there is any unclean way in you. But the gaze of your heart cannot, must not be constantly fixed on how am I doing. More than anything, your gaze has to be fixed on the Lord Jesus Christ. This is what we need. We need pastors and husbands and public preachers who care, like Paul did, what Jesus thinks about them, far more than what the world thinks about them. The world hated Paul, but the saints loved him, and Christ loved him. This is why Paul says, I don't lose heart. My eyes are fixed on Jesus. I got this ministry from him, so I don't lose heart no matter what happens. He suffered more than all of us combined will probably ever suffer for the gospel's sake, for Christ's sake. And this man, bearing more weight than all of us combined could bear, says, I do not lose heart. That should show you the power of looking continually at the Lord Jesus Christ, beholding his glory. What a strengthening power it really is. As men courageously shepherd the flock of God that is among them, may God use that to embolden men and women in all vocations to boldly speak the truth, to speak the word of God with their eyes firmly fixed on Jesus. It's because men and women, boys and girls who have the eyes of their heart fixed on Christ and are constantly thinking about the Lord Jesus, they don't care what the world thinks about them. If you care what the world thinks about you, you probably need to look at Jesus a lot more. If you're destroyed when the world hates you, get your eyes up to Jesus. They hated your master. The servant is not greater than the master. So this is the first thing that we need to do. We need to behold the glory of Jesus, and that is the way that we won't lose heart. Take your eyes off Christ, and like Peter, you will sink. Keep your eyes on Christ, and you will, by God's grace, walk above the waters of adversity. You'll be able to say with Paul, we do not lose heart. There's the first point. There's verse 1. This is why he doesn't lose heart. The second direction for us as we preach the gospel is you must not practice disgraceful, underhanded ways. As you preach the gospel, you must not practice disgraceful, underhanded ways. Look at the first part of verse 2. But we have renounced. That means we have disowned. We have forbidden ourselves. We have given up disgraceful, underhanded ways. Disgraceful means shameful, dishonorable, or it could mean dishonest ways. Disgraceful, underhanded, cunning, these words that are coming down the pike for us in this passage, they all have some thread in them of dishonesty. Some thread of dishonesty. He says, we've renounced, we've disowned disgraceful. It means shameful, underhanded, secret, concealed, hidden. It's the Greek word kryptos, which is where we get the word cryptic, something that's hidden, secretive, concealed. You see what he means? It's like we don't, when we preach, we don't try to hide anything from people. We don't try to hide something in the Word of God from them. We tell them the truth. We don't try to hide or bury the lead. We don't try to win people with giveaways. We don't try to win people with carnal means. We've renounced these disgraceful, underhanded ways. McShane points out that what he may be even getting at is just this unholy life of a professed gospel preacher that would lead them to use disgraceful, underhanded ways as they preach. McShane is saying they have to be unholy themselves if they're going to use these unholy ways to preach. So he says, there are many ministers who are outwardly ceremonious, but inwardly they are not so. But this was not the case with Paul. I believe that we could not preach if we had not an evil heart. But we have gone to the fountain and got it washed. We have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty and disgrace. As you preach, you must not practice disgraceful, underhanded ways. Don't hide things, don't conceal things, don't do shameful things and say, the end justifies the means. That's not what, we're not allowed to do that as we preach. Third, in the next part of verse 2, he says, we refuse to practice cunning. We refuse to practice cunning. And so the direction here is as you preach the gospel, you must refuse to practice cunning. You must refuse to practice cunning. The word cunning, that means craftiness. The serpent in the garden was cunning. This means slick. It has the idea of false wisdom or trickery, shadiness, deviousness. He's saying when we preach the gospel, we've renounced underhanded, disgraceful ways. We refuse to practice cunning. We refuse to try, and this is what it looks like in our day and age. We refuse to try to emotionally or psychologically manipulate people into doing what we think they should do. We refuse to practice cunning. We will not be, I mean, just think of the serpent in the garden. Did God really say? That's cunning. And people who profess to be ministers of the gospel do the exact same thing today when they try to manipulate someone, not with just a clear word of God and preaching and teaching it, but they try to psychologically or emotionally manipulate people into making a profession of faith or to giving, even financially, something they should do. They should make a profession of faith, but not under coercion, not because you're slick and sly and crafty. And you put forth this trickery. We have refused to do anything like that. That's what you must do as you preach the gospel. Don't manipulate your children. Don't manipulate your wife. Don't manipulate anybody. Don't try to get them to do what they should do by cunning. And you're going to see exactly what we should do here in just a minute. These are all the negatives. We don't do these things. The fourth thing, the fourth direction, is in the next part of verse 2. He says, we refuse to practice cunning or to tamper with God's word. So that refuse word is tied also to the tamper with God's word. So he's saying, we refuse to tamper with God's word. This means we refuse to handle deceitfully. We refuse to alter it. We refuse to tinker with it or corrupt it or mingle with it wrong notions. This word could mean contaminate, dilute, falsify, cheapen. We don't take God's word and then try to manipulate the word to be saying what we want it to say. The first part is we don't practice cunning, so we don't try to manipulate people into believing or doing what we think they should do. And then the next part he's saying, and we refuse to tamper with God's word. We're not going to try to manipulate the word of God and then say, well, it was just like the word did it. Like, because you twisted it, you corrupted it. We refuse to tamper with God's word. God will judge you and I. He will judge our labors based on what we did with his word. So think to yourself, do I tamper with God's word? Do I try to make it fit the way that I think things are already? Paul says we refuse. We refuse to tamper with God's word. And so must you if you're going to preach the gospel. Fifth, now we get to the positives. As you preach the gospel, you must openly state the truth. This is set against the tampering. If you're tampering with God's word, you're not openly stating the truth. If you're practicing cunning, you're not openly stating the truth. If you're practicing deceitful schemes and underhanded ways, you're not openly stating the truth. Paul's saying, in contrast to all these, we just speak, thus saith the Lord. This is what the word of God says. This is what it means. This is what it means for you. This is what you must believe and therefore do. But openly state the truth. Look at the next part of verse 2. But by the open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. He's saying we would appeal to other people's consciences and say, all I'm telling you is what God says. Should I not say what God says? That's all I'm doing. And so even the person who's receiving it should be able to go, their conscience should bear witness within them that, well, all they're saying is what God says in his word. By the open statement of the truth, we would commend ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. Like the apostles in Acts 4, this is exactly what they did when they were told, stop preaching Christ in Jerusalem. You guys have filled this city with your teaching. You're trying to bring Christ's blood against us. But they say, and this is them appealing to the conscience, whether it is right in the sight of God to listen to you rather than to God, you must judge. That's them. They have openly stated the truth, and they're just commending themselves to their consciences and saying, what do you think? Should we obey you or God? Judge for yourselves. And their conscience will bear witness that, well, in that scenario, you should obey God. And the apostles are going, right. So they openly state the truth. That's why in verse 20 of Acts 4, they say, for we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard. Openly state the truth. This is why I constantly advocate for you men. In any way that you're preaching or teaching God's word, preach it simply, plainly, write it clearly so that people actually understand what you're trying to say. explain it in a way that children can understand it. Explain it in a way that an 80-year-old can understand it at the same time. Everyone needs you to just speak the truth and make it plain. Open statement of the truth, commending ourselves to everyone's conscience in the sight of God. Some people try so to complicate things because they think in any kind of teaching the Bible or preaching that they have to have worldly wisdom added into it. It's got to have just this beautiful flow or structure, or the way that I use words. Like, that's not what we need. We need men who will just openly tell us the truth. What does God say? What should I believe? What should I do? That's what we need. And that's what you must do as you preach the gospel. Sixth, as you preach the gospel, you have to remember that everyone in their natural state is spiritually blind. As you preach the gospel, you're openly stating the truth, you're refusing all of those underhanded ways. But you have to remember, like Paul says in verses 3 and 4, everyone in their natural state is spiritually blind. Look at verse 3. And even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing. In their case, the God of this world has blinded the minds of the unbelievers to keep them from seeing the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. Everybody's born spiritually blind. You have to remember that as you're preaching the gospel to your children, especially those of you. They're born blind. You don't yell at a blind person for not being able to see yet. Openly state the truth to them. And remember that until God causes the new birth to happen, people won't repent. They won't believe. Unbelievers will not act like believers, and we shouldn't expect them to act like believers. They're blind. Do you see, working backwards through what we've seen already in this passage, just think with me. Do you see why it is so crucial that you and I do not practice disgraceful, underhanded ways? Because what you're doing is being disgraceful and underhanded with blind people. Why we must refuse to practice cunning or tamper with God's word. You see why it's crucial that we simply openly state the truth. It's because of this reality that he points out in verses 3 and 4. And here's where it all comes to a head. This is the point that I want to stick, and the point that he's making. You cannot trick a blind person into seeing. You can't be underhanded. You can't be cunning enough. You can't tamper with God's word enough to make a blind person see. And that's what ministers of the gospel, or professed ministers, are doing when they're trying to practice underhanded ways or tampering with God's word, softening things in the scripture because it's just too abrasive. You're trying to trick a blind person into seeing. That's not how they get sight. You can, however, trick a blind person into saying that they see. You can't trick them into seeing, but you can trick them into making a false profession of whether or not they truly do see. Don't you see Jesus? All you have to say is, I see Jesus. And a blind person, if you put enough manipulative pressure on them, may go, yeah, I see. If you say you see, you'll have eternal life. I see. And they're still blind. We have to be content with doing what Paul did. Openly state the truth. We know that everybody's blind until God shines light in their darkness. The seventh direction. As you preach the gospel, you must preach Christ and not yourself. Preach Christ and not yourself. Look at verse 5. For what we proclaim, what we preach, is not what? What's that word? What we proclaim is not ourselves. We do not preach ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, with ourselves as your servants, your slaves, for Jesus' sake. As you preach the gospel, you need to be very, very careful not to preach yourself. If you're the illustration, if you use an illustration and you're in it, you should probably be the antagonist, which means you're the bad guy that needs saving, not the hero. I don't like using stories of my life. I don't like writing that. Sometimes off the cuff something comes and it's, this happened, and maybe it'll be helpful. But be very careful in preaching the Bible that you're just always talking about yourself. You're not there to preach you. You're there to preach Christ. In any kind of conversation you have about Jesus, it ultimately has to be focusing on him. Because just what Paul says, what we proclaim is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, with ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. Robert Murray McShane, again, said, when it comes to this, he says, we do not preach the fancies of ourselves, but the truth of Christ. By fancies, he means we don't preach our opinions. We preach the truth of Christ. McShane even recalls, one evening lately, I was passing by a building and I heard a man speaking who seemed in earnest. I stopped and listened. He was preaching about laws and politics. I said, that man may preach to the day of judgment, but he will never make the people holy. But we preach Christ Jesus the Lord, so that you may be made holy. We preach the truth of Christ, not the fancies of ourselves. McShane says, secondly, what that means is we do not preach ourselves as the end, as the goal, as the hero. We do not preach ourselves as the end, but Christ. McShane, I believe that all worldly teachers preach themselves as the end. But this is not the object of faithful ministers. It is not that you may praise them, but Christ Jesus the Lord. Again, looking back upon our ministry, he's saying to his congregation, though I am not more free from fault than other men, I would not be a minister another day if it were only for a name. But if we are Christ's, he will make us preach himself. I sometimes feel, brethren, that I would willingly lie down beneath the sod in the churchyard and be forgotten and trampled on if only you were friends of Christ. That's what a minister does. Says, let me die if everyone here loves Jesus and are friends of Christ. So what we proclaim is not ourselves, not the fancies of ourselves, not the opinions, not ourselves as the hero or the goal or the end, but Christ, all of Christ. Eighth, as you preach the gospel, remember that if anyone is saved or sanctified, it is because God has shined light in their darkness. It is because God has shined light in their darkness if anyone is saved or sanctified. You have to keep, that's why I say remember. You have to remember that. The only way people get converted is verse 6. For God, who said, let light shine out of darkness, has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. That's the only way somebody gets saved. He's drawing us back to the creation of the world and saying, the reason we just preach Christ, openly state the truth, is because people are blind. And the only way anyone gets saved is we tell them the truth, and the same God who said, let there be light, and there was light, says that in a sinner's heart. It's like, you can't manipulate God to do that. You can't manipulate people into getting God to shine light into their hearts. You can't do any of that. So you just openly state the truth, and remember, people are blind until God shines light in their darkness. This is what God has done to you, men. Are you a believer? Do you rest in Christ's finished work for you? Do you glory in Christ Jesus and not in yourselves, not in your flesh? Do you know my only hope in life and in death is that I'm not my own, but I belong both body and soul to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He has fully paid for my sins. Is that you? The only reason you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ is because the same God who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has shone in your heart. Has shone in your heart to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Ninth, as you preach the gospel, this is also in verse 6, you must be able to preach from personal experience. You must preach from personal experience. Look at the way Paul talks in verse 6. We learn a principle there that helps us, but he's speaking experientially. He doesn't say, God who said, "Let light shine of dark, light shine out of darkness," has shone in your hearts. He says, has shone in our hearts. He knows, he has experienced the reality through what he's talking about, of what he's talking about. He has been born again. He actually is a believer. His faith is in the Lord Jesus Christ. Men, you cannot preach the gospel faithfully unless you have been born again, unless you have turned from your sin, unless God has shined light in your darkness. Stop preaching the gospel. Stop teaching the Bible if you're unconverted, and go to Christ. Beg God, if you're saying, "I'm unconverted," beg God to shine light in your darkness. You have to have personally experienced conversion. You have to be able to preach to others and tell them, go to Christ and he will receive you. You have to be able to do that from experience that I've gone to Christ and he received me. You know that you can tell sinners to go to him. You know that he'll forgive them. You know the truth that you're proclaiming. You got to be like Paul and be able to say what he's saying here. You have to have experienced this reality. You must have been born again. Plead with God. If you find yourself there, that I'm still dead, I'm faking, I understand the gospel, but I don't trust Christ from the heart. Beg God to shine light in your darkness so that you may preach and even preach from your personal experience. Has God shone in your heart? Has he given the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of his perfect Son? If he has, praise him and preach him faithfully. Pray with me. Our Father in heaven, we thank you again for your word. We ask you to help all of us preach from our personal experience. Convert anyone who's not yet in Christ. Shine light in their darkness. And those of us that you have united to your Son, you have made alive, help us to praise you, to weep for our sin, and weep for joy because of who Christ is for us. We thank you for sending him to be the propitiation for our sins. We thank you that he has put away our sin. We thank you for Christ crucified. We ask you to help us be men who do not lose heart and faithfully preach the truth in any of the spheres that you've given us to preach in. May you be glorified. In Christ's name we ask. Amen.